Now, the number of COVID-19 cases in the country remains on the rise. Now, the daily toll now averages 300 cases, with some days going as high as 600. Many blame this on the outright disregard for safety measures put out by the government and the World Health Organization on how to stem the spread of COVID-19. Now, this not only increases the risk of spreading the infection, it also threatens the already weak health sector in Nigeria, as cases have now surpassed available bed spaces for COVID-19 patients in many states. Joining me now is Ehide, CEO, Occupational Health and Safety Managers. Ehide, good morning. It's good to have you join me right now. I believe you've been following, yes, thank you. I believe you've been following the trend. People are complaining that others, a lot of people, especially in the city like Lagos and Abuja, are not being conscious of the safety protocols that are put on ground by the NCDC, WHO and the federal government. And it seems there's nothing anybody is doing about it when it comes to the authorities. What are your concerns?
Well, thank you so much. These are the issues, some of the issues that we're all worried about. And worry in the sense that if this is not taken care of, there might be a second wave of the COVID-19, and that will be more deadly. I go around the city, and it looks like, in Lagos, where I live, it looks like there is nothing going on. I mean, COVID-19 has ended, because everybody just go about doing what he or she likes, and the government just sits aloof, and nothing is done. This is scaring, because the way it is going, if we allow it to continue like this, even the way we are already, I mean, you can see the numbers going up the way it is. I don't know what's going on, but I think everything falls back to government. If there are procedures and protocols that should be followed and obeyed, I think the right to enforce those procedures and protocols lies in the coffers of government. And if they are not doing that, well, we should be prepared for a new wave of COVID-19, which, of course, I think, like you said, it will overwhelm all of us, and the fatality and mortality would be a number that would be painful to all of us.
All right. From the reports we're getting, even from the federal government, it seems that it would not be out of place to impose another lockdown on a city like Lagos, for instance. What would you say if that happens?
Mike, you remember the last time I was in your studio, I mentioned this. Mm. You cannot ease the lockdown on a city when the curve is not flattening. It was too an early decision to start having what you call a gradual release of the lockdown. It doesn't make any sense to me, because you can only talk of unlocking a city when you see drastic change. I mean, driving down the figures, and you can say with these figures that we have right now, we think it's ideal to gradually start unlocking the city. We didn't see those changes. We saw the figures rising, and the decision of the government was to gradually unlock the city. It was a total mistake, in my estimation. And what that brings to us is yet to come. And it's not just the Nigerian government that is doing that. If you look across Africa, look at countries like South Africa, their cases are going up, but they're also trying to unlock the city gradually. Look at Kenya. Look at even Ghana. But the question I want to ask here to African leaders is, must we sacrifice human life at the expense of economy? You can't, because of economic gains, throw all that we think we have gotten from the lockdown, throw them into the abyss, and here we are starting all over again. I think it wasn't the right decision, and the outcome is going to be very disastrous for us all.
All right, but the argument that is put forth by some analysts say that Nigeria, for instance, or many of the sub-Saharan African countries cannot afford to keep the economy closed because they don't have what it takes to sustain it for that long. So it becomes really difficult to balance the living and livelihoods. What do you say?
It would have been proper. Yes, that argument I understand. It would have been proper if we had machineries in place, like your first question. We say we want to unlock the country, but you should be sure that people who are available in that country are able to follow protocol, and there's a compliance to those guidelines. When there is absolute disregard to those guidelines, and you're looking at unlocking the city because you cannot take it because of the economic issue, I mean, that's not a sound argument. You could do that if the people were, if there was absolute adherence to those guidelines. You can say, okay, yes, from behavior we are seeing being put up, I think we can take this risk. But this risk we're taking right now was not well calculated, and it's going to be terrible on us all. And that's just the truth, because behavior hasn't changed, the figures hasn't come down. I mean, you cannot sacrifice, you cannot take, I mean, you need healthy people to build the economy to start with. And that should be taken into cognizance. When the people that you are thinking about are being the economy, when half of them are no more, what is the economy? That is my point.
Mm. All right. One other issue that I'd like you to talk about is the issue of awareness. A lot of people, the awareness and enlightenment of COVID-19 has been everywhere, where people are talking about it, especially in the cities. But it is still in the cities that a lot of people are not doing anything about, like you said. They're just going about their normal. How would you decipher the fact that people hear about COVID? In fact, you see people having their face mask not on their faces, but under their chins, which means they have an idea of what COVID-19 is, but they're not complying with how to use these things.
Yes, we see that every day. And what we should do is, when you see that, just stop and correct the person and let him know why he has to use the nose mask. And that's what we should do. I think, to a great extent, the level of advocacy that was there was strong. But understand also that if you look at the country, there were some body languages that totally distorted what the government was doing. And that made people suspect that this could just be a horse. Look at Kogi State. That's a leader. That's a governor. Look at Cross River State. That's a governor. You don't live in a state where people want to hear leadership speak. When leaders speak, everybody listen and do accordingly. But when you hear leaders come out to say, this is a scam and this is not correct, there's no harmony, no harmony amongst even the leadership of the country in terms of coronavirus prevention or fight against COVID-19. And you find out that when you have such languages that are counterproductive coming out from such quarters, people begin to take it as if, well, it may just be a scam. And you find out that if they were complying, they just switch from their compliance behavior and do otherwise. And this is what we are doing. Until we harmonize, bring everybody to the same table, and we all have the same understanding from leadership down to the citizenry, we'll have this problem. Because now some governors are coming and saying that this is not real, and they have followers, they have people that live in that state. And what do you expect them to behave? They will just do as the governor said, that this is not real, so I can just behave the way I want to behave.
Okay, there needs to be synergy between the authorities and the government. All right, thank you so much for your time, Ehide, for your time on the program. Thank you so much. Joining me now is Ehide, CEO, Occupational Health and Safety Managers. Ehide, good morning. It's good to have you join me now. Now, let's start from the overwhelming numbers that are going up, that are surpassing the available bed spaces in isolation centers. Just how scary is this, and how helpless is the health agencies when it comes to managing the numbers that are increasing by the day?
Well, I think I just managed to hear what you said, and looking at the numbers that are overwhelmingly high in the isolation centers. Well, that is the state we're in right now, because what we ought to do as a people, we didn't do it. And from beginning, we didn't track business properly. And you are seeing numbers, I mean, coming out every day. I mean, you see the numbers that come out every day. And they have to have a place they flow into, and that's the isolation center. And this is the fear that we all have. If what we currently have as a country is not checked, well, a time will come, I mean, that people will not have a place to be housed when they have visible symptoms or confirmed cases of coronavirus. We have to stay at home. And this is why everybody has been advocating that the guidelines and the protocols of prevention that were marked by the government, we have to follow them judiciously, so that we don't reach the state that we're in right now. And this is becoming very painful and scary. Like you said, the healthcare system is already very fragile, And with the way things are going, it's going to be very, very, it's a disaster that is looming ahead if things don't change in as quick as possible.
All right. Now, international agencies like WHO and even the Bill and Melinda Gates at the beginning or inception of the pandemic had said that there could be worse scenarios of COVID-19 in sub-Saharan African countries. Nigeria is not an exception into this. Are we beginning to see the scary picture they painted at that time? Is that what we're beginning to see now?
It is too early to assume that. I know why they were making such assumptions were because of the fragility of the healthcare system, the weak healthcare system we have in Africa. That was what they were basing their assumptions on. But we have to wait to see from the way it's going with the, yes, it's high, but I don't think it's at reached that magnitude that, oh, it's looking at that magnitude that Belinda Gates and Co. were describing. But the figures we have right now is actually disturbing, and I think we have to do something as quickly as possible. I saw in the headline today that government is reconsidering shutdown of Lagos State again, which of course, I mean, that's what we should have done earlier. When the cases were rising, we're opening the state up, and look at the street, look at the mess that you see every day. So it's frightening. What we would have done that we didn't do is what we are going back to go and do again, and that is where the problem is.
All right. Now, let's narrow it down to the issue of compliance to some of these guidelines. We see there's a guideline from the NCDC health authorities, Ministry of Health, and even the government. And the PTF, the Presidential Task Force, has been communicating with people on daily basis, reminding them what to do and how to do. If you go to states, they're doing the same thing. As much as it remains a persuasive thing to do when it comes to the hygiene, social distancing, and all of that, does government have the capacity to instill these compliances? Hey, have I lost your line? Okay. Oh, okay.
You're back again now.
All right. Okay. Now,
can you just take that question?
Yes,
again?
I was saying that, does the government have the capacity to instill this compliances in the people, all the guidelines that we've been talking about over the months?
You see, one thing I understand is that when people know the reason why they are doing what they have to do, compliance is easy. So we have to focus on why we have to do what we have to do. That's the way we should communicate to our people. Let them know what is in it for us all to lose, so that all those minds and the confusion that is in the land is out. And secondly, you realize why people are doing what they're doing, because we have huge level of informal sector. People, if they don't go to work on a daily basis, they have no food to eat. And they were the first set of people that broke out to go into the street, because they stayed at home every day, they have no food to eat, and they have to go to work. So this is also a very confounding factor that is fueling all that is happening right now. People will have to work on a daily basis to be able to eat. And you see, this government has no control over it as at now. These are things that should have been put in place, looked at early enough, knowing that informality of sector of informal sector economy that is so huge will not allow us to have a high level of compliance, I mean, in the right sense. And that's where we've got to right now.
All right. Excuse me. Hey, Ede, thank you so much for your time on the program. We really appreciate you.